gentlemen, and welcome. Now, before I go into the script proper, I'd just like to say a few words of my own, because this was written for me, you see. I'm supposed to stick rigidly to this script, but I'm here now, I'm up here, and I can do what I like. I would just like to thank the people who organized this evening for inviting me along to take part in what we hope will be a very special occasion. I was born in Upper Coll, and I spent most of my life in Broad Bay, U, and I'm very pleased, and I'm privileged, and proud to have been asked to come along and to be part of this very special evening in a very special time in all our lives. And we had a rehearsal last night of the show, and it lasted 4 hours, but the good news is we managed to cut 10 minutes off that, so it should be some time. But seriously, realistically, we're looking at about an hour and a half if I behave myself and I don't wander, as I'm doing now from the script. We have a lot of talent for you, vocal talent here for you this evening, to take you through the story of the century. And I'm very pleased to be up here with the choir. They're really nice people, despite the rumours you hear about the mort and things like that. I can always pretend that I'm part of the choir tonight. I'm a singer. It's nice to be up here with them. And so that's that part of it. So good evening again, and welcome to what can only be a very short look back at the century that is just coming to an end. What we hope to do over the next hour and a half is take a journey through the century. We hope to show you the clothes people have worn during the past 100 years. We hope to remember some of the key events and personalities of the last 100 years, locally, nationally, and internationally. We shall also try and reproduce some of the music that spans the whole of the century, particularly the music that was and is most well known in our own area. Queen Victoria was still on the throne at the beginning of the century. She died in 1901 and was succeeded by her son, Edward VII. The Victorian influence was still very much in evidence after Queen Victoria died. This was reflected in the clothes that were worn at the time. The crinoline was out of fashion and had been replaced by a much narrower skirt with a bustle, a pad which made the skirt puff out from behind. The bodice was still narrow, and women still suffered the squeeze of a corset. In the evening, elegant men wore black dinner jackets with a white shirt, along with a top hat and cane. Can you just see them in the road in Upper Coll with a top hat and cane? I don't think so. Mind you, there were some very posh people in Outer Coll, or they thought they were posh. They start talking and then you realise that. Now the bustle, the thing sticking out the back of the skirt, that's the bustle. Now this was before the word brassiere was invented. So the thing at the front is called the hustle. So when the woman were in a voice check getting ready for a night out, that's when the men would come in and say, come on, what's all this hustle and bustle, get on with it. If you believe that, well, believe anything. When the century dawned, a lady who is still with us was 2 months short of her second birthday. I'm talking about Katie Bell Yorishporshta from Coll. As the next century dawns, she will be just 2 months short of her 102nd birthday. I will refer to her as the evening goes on in the hope that her life story will illustrate the life in this district during the century. 1902 saw the end of the Boer War, waged in South Africa. 1903 is recorded as the year the Wright brothers flew the first aeroplane, one of the many inventions that have changed people's lives beyond all recognition over the last 100 years. Katie Bell went to Bath School at 5 years of age in 1903. These were the times when a peat under the arm or the classroom fire was as important as any book. This has been a century of huge advances in science. Einstein's theory of relativity was first published in 1905. During the first decade, we also saw the first mass-produced motor car. This was Henry Ford's famous Model T. Britain had 4 prime ministers during the first decade of the century, They were, at the very beginning, Lord Salisbury, a Tory, followed by Arthur James Balfour, then Henry Campbell Bannerman, a Liberal, in 1905, and H.H. Asquith, Liberal, in 1908. Our minister at Bath at the beginning of the century was the Reverend Hector Cameron. The headmaster was Donald Ross, and he was followed in 1908 by William G. Morrison. It was in 1903 that the first tweed mill opened in Stornoway, but during the first decade, apart from the croft, it was the fishing that was the main income provider. The sight of hundreds of fisher girls gutting from morning to night for 3 pennies a barrel is surely a sight never to be repeated. The herring industry stretched from Lerwick to Yarmouth, with many island girls spending their year in this way. Days of sailing boats and the memorial at Breivik Pier is testament to the high cost that our community has paid as men went to sea in all kinds of weather, and that brings us to our first piece of music. Large quantities of identical garments in different sizes and colours. This was to be the beginning of mass-produced clothes. When we think of the second decade of the century, we think mainly of the First World War and the huge cost to our country, as our island paid to secure victory over Germany. But before war was declared in 1914, we had a coronation in 1911. That was when King George V ascended to the throne. The following year saw the sinking of the unsinkable with a huge loss of life. I'm talking, of course, about the luxury liner, the Titanic. I'm sure we have all seen the film made in recent times on the subject of the Titanic's first and final voyage. 1912 was also the year when Katie Bell left Bath School. The leaving age then was 14. The First World War started when Archduke Franz Ferdinand was assassinated in Sarajevo. That was a time when many hundreds of our island's young men were called up to serve king and country. Quite a number of them had served and had training in the militia. They were among the first to go. Katie Bell was in Fraserburgh along with many other island girls at the herring gutting when war was declared in 1914. Saw the Easter Rising in Ireland, a rebellion which ultimately led to the Irish Republic being formed. 1917 saw the Russian Revolution, when the Bolsheviks displaced the Tsars and set up a new system which became known as communism. As all this was going on, hundreds of thousands of men were being killed in the fields of Flanders. Names such as Ypres, the Vimy Ridge and the Somme were very familiar to a generation of Islanders. This tune was composed in remembrance of the Battle of the Somme. Time of crisis. They sought solace and comfort in songs and music.
Thank you.
celebrated the freedom they had gained from their war efforts. The term flambeur was used to describe fashionable women. Skirts were shortened, laced corsets and tight-fitting clothes were to be a thing of the past, and the hair was cut short. As we entered the third decade of the century, the herring fishing was thriving, and a common sight for the next 70 years was introduced to our community, the Hattersley loom, which made the weaving of tweed much easier than the old hand looms. The early 20s saw the Upper Col and Gress land raids, when young men who had fought for king and country returned not to a land fit for heroes as they had been promised, but to an island where they had neither land nor houses for their families. They raided the Col and Gress farms in spite of warnings of the dire consequences, and divided them into crofts and built homes for their families. Without their actions, we wouldn't have these two villages, as four generations have now known them. This was also the time Katie Bell married Donald Stewart, Dol Haragan, from two doors away in Col. There was no Caberfei wedding, but the traditional Rejoch, that was the official betrothal, the wedding itself and the Benish Tay, followed not by a honeymoon, but by life in the Tadu. Soon a young family arrived, Jean first in 1922, another daughter who died as a young girl as a result of appendicitis, followed by George in 1929. By then, they had built and moved into the Taigal in 1925. Life was hard. Donald had left the fishing when he got married. He began building houses and weaving. The horse was used for all the heavy work. They kept two cows and a calf and cultivated all the land they had available to them. Donald was also involved in the Upper Col raids. He did a lot of the letter writing on behalf of those wanting land and new houses. But the 1920s was a time when many young islanders decided to try and seek their fortune in the huge expanses of Canada and the United States. Many hundreds left from Stornoway on well-known ships such as the Metagama and the Marlow. Many were successful, but quite a number returned during the Depression of the early 1930s.
Smell your hair, and hear the
that was lovely. Lord Leverhulme gifted the island to the people as there was no enthusiasm for the job generation schemes which he proposed. The area between Stornoway and Tolsta and Stornoway and Point accepted the offer. This area is still under the jurisdiction of the trust formed by Lord Leverhulme, the Stornoway Trust. The 1920s saw the first Labour Prime Minister in Ramsay MacDonald. That was in 1924. The Education Act, Scotland, 1872, ensured that all children received education. But as can be seen from the school logs of that time, absences were frequent. Poverty was real. And as one extract read, and I quote, "The stormy weather prevents those recovering from the flu to come to school, as they have no boots and cannot venture barefooted." That was on the 19th of May, 1922. Also in June of that year, the log reads, "The compulsory officer called, as usual, and reports that many of the children are suffering from cut feet and want of food." The compulsory officer was a person appointed to ensure that the children attended school. He was better known as the Whipper Inn, or Whipper Inn. The writing tools of that day were the slate and the pencil, and as Katie Bell and her friends had found, each child was expected to take a peat with him to school to keep the fire burning. Now, I was born in 1951 and I went to school in 1956, and I remember the first class that I went to was the ABC, and I had a slate given to me about the size of this page with a wooden border around it. And if I remember rightly, we got a little lead pencil, and I would take advice on this, but I think we called it a slate ban. There you are now. And I'm only 48. It was in 1926 that the general strike took place. The first time everyone donned tools to support a miners' dispute. In that year, John Logie Baird first demonstrated television. In the islands, however, people still made their own entertainment. They gathered to listen and dance to the music of the melodeon. A favourite venue would be the local bridge. Thank you. couple of screw tops, yes, but not some. It wasn't until 1928 that women were given the same voting rights as men as a result of the Equal Franchise Act. That was also the year of the first Walt Disney film and an important medical discovery, penicillin. But the decade ended in the depth of a recession. It started when the Wall Street stock market collapsed. Many businesses went broke and there was mass unemployment in the United States, Canada, and the United Kingdom. Modeling a Harris Tweed costume. I don't know whose jeans. Are they Levi's or not? I've got a jewelry for you. '35 was the year which saw a young Malcolm K. McMillan beginning a long parliamentary career when he was elected the first Labour MP for the Western Isles. This was a time when many young Island men were in the Royal Naval Reserve as the country prepared for possible hostilities with Germany. It was the time of a constitutional crisis when King George V died and he was succeeded by Edward VIII, who abdicated in order to marry a divorcee, Mrs. Wallis Simpson. It was then that King George VI and Queen Elizabeth came to the throne. Germany invaded Czechoslovakia in 1938 in spite of Hitler's promises of peace to Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain. In 1939, Germany invaded Poland. It was at this point that Britain declared war. It was time for the call-up once again.
Thank you.
clothes of the previous period, which had been drawn with bolder outlines, no waist, and a denial of feminine curves, gave way to a longer, leaner, and more figure-hugging silhouette, which defined the waist, accentuated the shoulders, and narrowed the hips. Fur, both of the expensive and cheap varieties, was worn extensively throughout the 1930s. It was in 1940 that Winston Churchill one of the century's great leaders, became Prime Minister of the United Kingdom. His leadership inspired patriotism and loyalty, and ultimately victory over the forces of fascism and Hitler. In 1941, the United States entered the war after the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor and destroyed many American warships. Rationing came into effect in the summer of 1941. You know, when you see these guys, it makes you realize that something happens here, but okay. Saw the introduction of the utility clothing scheme, which restricted, among other things, the amount of cloth that could be used in garments. These limitations gave rise to simple designs. Wartime shortages were often a spur to creativity. Go through your wardrobe, the government urged. Make do and mend. Make do and mend became a byword in many families for many years. A phrase I would use more often myself if I got away with it, but there you have it. In 1943, Alexander Matheson became headmaster of Bath School. His great-grandchildren are members of Bath Junior Youth Club at this time.
And I'm going back to God.
finally secured when Japan surrendered in 1945 after the terrible losses in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. These losses were inflicted with the first use of atomic bombs. Labour won a landslide election in 1945. Churchill's government was defeated and he was replaced by Clement Attlee. In 1946, we saw the beginning of what we now know to be the computer industry, when IBM produced the first electronic brain, as it was called. In 1947, the new government commenced the process of nationalizing some of the country's most important industries and services. They started with the coal mines. In Bath, we had a new minister in 1947. He was the Reverend Alexander MacLeod, the late Reverend Bodo Alec MacLeod's father. He succeeded the Reverend Mackenzie on his death after many years in Bath. 1948 was the year the National Health Service was created. This meant that the ability to pay was no longer a consideration. One was entitled to health care, no matter how poor one was. Gandhi, who was famous as a philosopher and politician in India, was assassinated in 1948. The years following the war brought many changes to Britain and the island of Lewis. Katie Bell remembers when she no longer had to heat the iron by the fire, when she no longer had to go to the well for water. Many had the use of electricity for the first time. Many had running water for the first time. And many of our village roads saw tar for the first time. They also saw the introduction of bus services, the Peel, Milo, the Company, where Gordon says now, and then John Mitchell and others. It was in the post-war years that the church midweek service was changed from 12 noon to 7 o'clock on Thursday night. This was to meet for the changing pattern of employment, when many people were employed in jobs which required them to work specific hours. Previously, they arranged their own work times. This was the time when gramophones appeared in many island homes. Accordion music was very popular, especially Jimmy Shan, when he played tunes like Whistling Woofers and the Bluebell Polka.
Sun and round.
She does remember when her mother got it that she received 10 shillings. Her grandmother's was half that, 5 shillings. As we entered the 60s, the pace of change in our society speeded up. We saw the glamour and then the murder of President John F. Kennedy. We heard the speeches and then the news of the murder of Martin Luther King as the black people of America fought for equal rights. We saw a decade of sexual liberation. The flower power years and the beginning of pop music, with famous names like the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, Cilla Black and Lulu coming to the fore. Easy care synthetic fabrics such as crinkling, dacron and terling were much used during the 1960s. I remember it well. Long hair, sideburns. We witnessed the war in Vietnam and further advances in science. Neil Armstrong was the first man on the moon in 1969, and Dr. Christian Bernard was the first to conduct a successful heart transplant operation. That was in South Africa in 1967. Harold Wilson became Labour Prime Minister in 1964. In fact, weaving was still the main industry. The 1960s saw fishing in Broad Bay die out as the haddock stocks became depleted. But according to the front page of the Gazette this week, they are some super crabs. The familiar sights of Eher Harmans Nil and motoring out from Breivik and the peals from Upper Col, from Col, were no more. Katie Bell's family were by now well into adulthood. Jane, a cook, George, a Met officer, and Donald, a teacher. The peats were still being cut. Now there were good tractors to take them home. As in many other households, however, the cow was no longer part and parcel of life on the croft. And we entered the 1960s with a new school and a new headmaster. The new school was opened in 1967. The new headmaster in 1969 was John Murdo Macmillan, who was with us for the next 10 years. At this time, the traditional music of our island was changing. Murdo MacFarlane, the Melrose Bard, was writing songs which groups like Mahogany made very well known. Old things, new themes, but with new tunes and a new swing. Accessories or wearing hats and gloves. They had their own choice of music, which governed choice of clothes. Men's fashion, as always, moved more slowly than women's through the 1970s, though the 1970s witnessed a more obvious change in design detail than previous decades. The suit still dominated, but with subtle changes to jacket fit and shape, length, button fastening, and the width of lapels, which grew almost to cover the chest towards the close of the decade. The ideal shirt at the beginning of the 70s was spitted, pastel colored, and had a long pointed collar, and was teamed with a bright, wide, boldly patterned, colored kipper tie. Shillings and pence in 1971 when decimalisation was introduced. We joined the European Common Market in 1972, and in that year, Katie Bell and Donald celebrated their golden wedding. In 1975, we had our own local authority for the first time ever. Before then, local government took the shape of county councils and district council. Katie Bell remembers some of the councillors of days gone by. In Harnish, Kenneth McKeever, who ran the post office in the early days of the century, Alan Cameron, Reverend Roderick Mackenzie, Innes Naid, and Alec Halamil, Alec Morrison. The last county councillor for our area was Shortest the Cake, George Mackay. He had defeated the previous councillor, James McLennan, Jimmy Bullock. Then we had Corle Ninilla. And two councillors for our area. Peter MacLeod was the first Gress councillor, and Kenny MacDonald, now the Reverend Kenneth MacDonald, was the first councillor for Col. Prime Minister. He was succeeded again by Harold Wilson in 1974, Jim Callaghan in 1976, and in 1979, Mrs. Margaret Thatcher became became the first woman Prime Minister. Our MP at that time was Donald Stewart, who defeated Malcolm K. Macmillan in 1970. By the end of the 70s, we were able to see them all in their fleshly glory as coloured television came to the island for the first time. Celebrations in 1977 as the Queen celebrated her Silver Jubilee. In the United States, we heard of the Watergate break-in, which ended with President Nixon having to resign from the presidency. In Bath, we had a change of ministers. Following the Reverend Porter Macaulay's retirement, the Reverend Alistair Montgomery was inducted in 1975. And in 1979, Alec MacDonald became the headmaster of the school on John Porter Macmillan's retirement. 1978 was the year when Kosher Ogavak was formed. As they have on many previous occasions, they have recently returned from the Royal National Mod in Fort William with a hall of trophies. Our congratulations.
Thank you.
wonder what they do. It's like somebody having a seizure. I woke up many a morning like that. Alright. The 70s and the 80s brought us the music of Runrig, which gave a new image to the world of Gaelic music. A new, trendy image, unlike any that had gone before. Young musicians writing their own material about their own islands and performing in front of thousands who didn't even understand the language of their songs.
Sound of me a melody at the top of the end of the night.
occasions, a designer labelled jacket was often combined with blue denim jeans and an open neck silk shirt. I suppose after this is all over, the phrase, the all of the henna, that will be heard many times. So, for women, minimal elegance was the aim. The executive look, which has found expression as part of the working woman's dress in the 1970s, matured into what became known as power dressing. The style was based on the male silhouette and was achieved through a skirt suit, which combined a wide shoulder padded jacket with a feminizing short skirt. Fabric such as lycra became popular in this decade and was added to many materials. Leisure and sportswear had by this time merged with casual wear. Tracksuits became familiar on the street, while trainers and baseball caps found particular favour with the young. In 1980, Ronald Reagan became the oldest person ever elected as President of the United States. A former actor, he was very friendly with Mrs. Thatcher, and later, along with President Gorbachev of the USSR, oversaw the ending of the Cold War. Gorbachev also saw the breakup of the Soviet Union into its constituent nations. In 1981, Prince Charles married Diana Spencer, a marriage which bore two children, one William, our future king, and Harry. Sadly, it was to end up in tears and divorce and no fairy tale ending. Katy Bell, this year, lost her husband of almost 60 years. 1981 was the year our soldiers fought their last war defending British soil, the War of the Falkland Isles in the South Atlantic. Argentina claims the islands. They are populated by British people and many sheep and surrounded by rich waters. The Argentinian invasion was eventually repulsed, but the political debate continues between the two countries. 1986 was the year people's worst fears were realized when there was an explosion at an atomic power plant in Chernobyl in Russia. The effects were felt even in our islands when sheep meat was feared contaminated. The catastrophic results nearer to Chernobyl are being felt to this day. In 1987, Colin MacDonald succeeded Donald Stewart as MP for the Western Isles. The end of the 1980s saw the young people of China calling for democracy rather than communism. The result was brutal and costly in lives. Who will ever forget the pictures of the young man trying to stop the tanks from entering Tiananmen Square? He didn't manage, and the largest country on earth still does things its way and not ours. 1989 was the year the Bach Senior Choir Kosher Ski the Bach was formed. They too performed at this year's mod and brought silverware and honour to our district. century, the troubles in Northern Ireland, which have been with us for a whole generation, this time around were still with us. We have, however, seen an uneasy truce which hopefully will end up as a permanent peace. This decade also saw what we call the Gulf War, the West's response when Saddam Hussein's Iraq invaded the neighbouring Kuwait. He was supposed to have lost, but he still reigns in Baghdad. And seeing we're talking about war, we cannot forget the terrible atrocities following the breakup of Yugoslavia, when Croatia, Serbia and Bosnia attacked each other. Then later we saw the invasion of Kosovo by Serbia. Wars continue, and not just in our part of the world. There has been a huge loss of life in Africa in the last 10 years. Nearly every region has had its own war, and still does. Science continues to advance rapidly. Over the last 10 years, we have seen the personal computer becoming more and more powerful and in more and more homes. No business could function now without the use of a computer. We have also seen a revolution in communications with the introduction of the internet replacing letters, phone and even fax as the easiest and cheapest means of communicating with any part of the world in seconds. We no longer need libraries for research. It is all there on the internet. This new science has already given people in this island employment and looks as if it could take place of the loom in years to come. We no longer cut peats as we did. Sheep are not worth keeping. Tweed weaving is practically a thing of the past, and fish in Broad Bay is all part of history. During this decade, designer wear clothes are featured largely in all age groups. Even babies can be seen sporting clothes labelled Nike, Adidas and Wrangler. Without designer labels, cheap and expensive clothes look alike. Today, with children in particular, designer labels equate with status. Polar fleeces have become highly fashionable this decade, becoming an item in everybody's wardrobe, from the teeny tot to Bloxy or Ian Froggy out on the back moor. The 90s brought us John Major as Prime Minister, following Mrs. Thatcher's removal as Tory party leader. In the 1997 general election, Labour under Tony Blair won a landslide victory. The early 90s brought the world's media to our doorsteps when Corlin Yelland lost well over £20 million as a result of the bank known as BCCI collapsing with huge debts, but none as large as ours. We are still paying the price. We'll never get the money we lost back. The loss cost some of our top officials their jobs. Our headmaster during the 90s has been Donald A. Stewart, Donald Alistair O'Leharakan, Katie Bell's youngest son. He has been unwell recently, and we wish him a speedy and full recovery. In 1994, the new community hall at Abercall was opened by Andy Gray, the ex-footballer, Mac Ní Himsigó. In 1995, Reverend Ian D. Campbell's induction saw over 900 people sitting for a meal at the Abercall Community Centre, where we are tonight. The youth club is pleased he is on the adults' rota with many other parents, without whose help there couldn't be a youth club. He has immortalised us in psalm tunes of his own composition, Light Hill and Skull of Ark. 1997 was the year that saw the nation convulsed in grief on hearing of the death in a car crash in Paris of Princess Diana. It was also the year that saw the Bach district put its own newspaper for the first time ever. The Waterloo News was launched in April 1997. Earlier this year, we saw that science sometimes moves faster than we wanted to. When shops tried to sell us genetically modified foods, people made it clear that we didn't want them. Also on this year, on the 1st of July, Scotland had its own parliament for the first time in 300 years. Alistair Morrison became our first MSP. We have followed Katie Bell Stewart's journey through this century. The only person in fact who can truly say she has witnessed every moment of it. She has seen changes that could not possibly have been foreseen, even in the early years of her own life. She received the Queen's famous telegram in February 1998 when she was 100. And hopefully, in 6 weeks' time, she will be able to celebrate her third century in Col. We wish her good health and happiness. We are all looking forward to a new century, none more so than the young people of the youth club. So they were set a challenge by the leaders. How did they think teenagers would be dressed 100 years from now? On an evening when we are taking a sulalash, their challenge was to take a sulalau. Two outfits had to be designed, one for a boy and one for a girl. Some very interesting and unusual designs were submitted. The task then for the youth club committee was to ensure that these winning designs materialised as outfits. Our judge was Margaret Smith from Tongue. Tonight we present the winning designs brought to life by dressmakers Christine MacLeod and Rhoda McKeever. First, the winning design for a girl, designed and modelled tonight by Emma Murray. Our winning entry for a boy was designed by Laurie Stewart and is modelled tonight, excuse me, by Matt MacLeod. A wee ball at home, and if I ever seen dressed up like that, I'd probably, I don't know what I'd do. Now, can I call on Dorothy Kennedy, who has been responsible for gathering together all the clothes you have here, seen here tonight, to present the winners with their checks. Presentation, and that is for the winner of the Sulalash Youth Club logo competition. It is on the commemorative t-shirts and on tonight's program. The competition was won by Ross Hall. Thank you very much. Evening to a close. Before we end the evening by singing Psalm 23 to the tune Light Hill, I would like to call on Councillor Calmy and Graham, the councillor for the Col ward, to propose a vote of thanks.
And you want to hear me? How can I follow that? It gives me great pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, and children, as local councillor and as treasurer of the Bach Hall. The first person I have to thank is Kenny McKeever, Kenny Diog, better known as Kenny Diog. I don't know why I'm going to thank Kenny Keogh. Whenever I see Kenny Keogh, he's a referee. I'm on the line. He's got a whistle. Off! He sent me off already. This was his idea a few months ago, about 6 months ago. He has been chairman of the Sulalash subcommittee. He has worked tirelessly for the last, say, 3 months, but I would say more than that, 6 months. Without his efforts, the expedition you see around you would not have happened. He has done a first-class job. Perhaps Ishbal, his wife, who has helped him a great deal, will see more of him after tomorrow. one in the morning, we were having a cup of tea in the kitchen, and we were talking about Cherry Blair, who's expecting a child. And Kenny said that he was getting too old for this. He's 46, but then he remembered his wife was only 35. The other Kenny, Fatima, Kajakor, is here with us tonight. He has put the program together, you have seen tonight. He wrote the script and devised the music program. Now, I think he's done a good job of it. This has taken a long time for him to do. Next one is... Dorothy Kennedy has been in charge of the costumes, and what a job she has done. April assists by Christine Hall and this by McLean, and advised by Deirdre MacDonald from the Store of the Thespians. Later on, I'm sure you'll all enjoy the food prepared for you here tonight. There has been a lot of work done by a lot of people. The organising has been done by Joan McLean and Chrisanne Campbell, with the able assist of many throughout the district. Thanks to those who made sure we saw and heard all what was happening tonight. Willie McLeod, William Cohen, and Ian Stewart, who looked after the sound. And Robert Smith, who opened the lights. Thanks to Willie McLeod, Willie Massey, for agreeing to video tonight's proceedings, so that the children will know what kind of century we had. I think you all agree what you heard tonight, the music and everything was great. Thanks to all who were up on the stage. A special thanks to Andrew Dahandy, who told everyone what they had to do. A special thanks to Tom McKeever, for taking us through the century in his usual able manner. A night like tonight cannot happen without the backroom people. A special thanks to Dean Murray, the youthful section, who has looked after tickets and all administrative tasks. And Angus Mackay, who has helped with transport. Thanks to Kenny Pierce's helpers, this week were Kenny John McLeod and John Carmichael. And for all our help with the car parking arrangements. It's not easy to do this. There are many more I should thank. Many people have been tonight possible. Without the wholehearted support of the community, we wouldn't have such a successful evening. Finally, thank yourselves for coming out and supporting this work. By Bath Junior Youth Club.
Thank you, Councillor, for calling that. Now the choirs are going to bring the evening to conclusion by singing Psalm 23 to the tune Light Hill, and John Morrow Martin, affectionately known to us all as Purdy, will lead the singing. And please join in. The first three verses will be in English and the last two in Gaelic. Thank you.
again about this display that has been directed by Kenny Fiag and his helpers at the end of the hall here. I'm sure that you'll find it very well worthwhile having a look at it. The photographs, the stories about that in the cassette, and the many interesting artifacts. And I would urge you to please go and have a look. Myself, I want to thank you for being a lovely audience. It's been a pleasure for me to have stood up here and read a script that I must thank Kenny and Dorothy for. It was a lot of hard work, but it was very easy to work with. And finally, it's been a delight for me. I've been on the stage myself a few times since I was a boy, about 15, with Ronnie Bohan over there, and Kenny Hall and a few other parties. And it's been a delight for me to see the youth of the community being involved in this very special event tonight. Special instruction from the referee here, please help me walk of Andrew Octay. And finally, before we enjoy some of the traditional foods of our parents and grandparents, can I call on the youth club past chairman, Cal McLean, to say the grace. Bless us all.